This week's episode of the Totally Rad Show is brought to you by Squarespace.
The national fight against drunk driving, over the limit, under arrest.
And GoDaddy.
Yes, am I male?
Yes.
Wait, you were so certain?
Yes.
I guess so. Yes. Yeah.
Okay, there, that's very telling. Am I from a movie?
Yes. Yes.
Am I from a movie made in the 90s?
Yes.
Yes.
Am I transgender?
No.
Maybe?
No. Am I in my 20s?
No idea. No idea. How weird is that?
Am I a hero?
Yes.
No.
Am I a robot?
No.
No.
Am I an alien?
Yes.
Am I in a movie based on an existing property?
Yes.
Fascinating. Am I in a movie?
Fascinating. Fascinating.
Am I in a movie based on a video game?
No.
No.
Was there a video game made of this movie?
Yes. You're like, I'm asking questions in circles!
Am I in a comedy?
Yeah.
No.
Am I in an action comedy? Am I in a science fiction film?
Yes.
Sci-fi comedy?
No. No.
Is it a popular movie?
Yes.
Very popular movie made in the 90s. Am I CG or?
Yes.
I'm CG. Hold on. Do geeks hate me?
Yes!
Am I Jar Jar Binks?
Yes! Awesome. All right, okay, do me. Am I an actress? I'm not Hilary Swank.
Three rad guys living normal lives are recruited by a team of super spies. Their mission's classified, but you may surmise they battle evil by quoting movie lines. Game and TV guides are used like knives to quell the rise of demon samurais. We know it sounds contrived, but we tell no lies. It's as the name implies, the Totally Rad Show.
Hello and welcome to the Totally Rad Show, episode number 126. I'm Alex Albrecht.
I'm Jeff Cannata.
I'm Dan Trachtenberg.
Totally Rad Show is your weekly dose of all things rad.
Alex, allow me.
Oh, thank you.
We go down to the local party/beer/ World of Warcraft store.
I love it.
And
store.
Get all the things that are perfect for Alex's birthday.
Happy birthday to me. It's so funny that we do like double birthdays back to back.
I know, we're literally exactly 2 weeks apart.
Exactly 2 weeks apart. So yes, today, August 14th, when we're taping the show, is my legitimate birthdays. And you're like way... Earlier.
And
actually,
younger.
Actually, Mike's birthday is not too far off either.
Couple weeks. Nice. When's your birthday again, Mike?
September 12th.
So mark it.
Yeah. But happy birthday, bro.
No, thank you very much, I appreciate it. Been having a good time, worked out this morning.
Good.
Yeah, good little birthday workout.
I had a little phony meetings. I'm 33. Go.
It's going to be, no, we don't have time for this.
I know.
Too old.
Yeah. You stopped doing that at 12.
Yeah.
Mostly.
We are very excited to debut your present on the show.
Yes.
Is it the death machine? This is what you wanted to do. This
much like the death machine.
You made me the death machine.
Much like the death machine, it has to be built.
Yeah, so it's not quite ready.
It'll be
ready
unveiled
yet
on the show.
But let's talk about the death machine since you brought it up.
Yes, best.
Amazing.
Possibly my favorite background ever, which is us. Sam Line sent this in, which is us in his perpetual death machine.
He's designed us a totally rad death machine, which, you know, we didn't know we wanted, but now we do.
Dude, I've never wanted any more in my life. All right, except getting into the show, shall we? Huh.
This week in movies, we have two huge, massive movie reviews for you. Also, the last two movies, fittingly, of the summer.
Oh.
Of our summer of
chance.
I mean, like, there's other movies coming out. Obviously, the summer is not officially over, but this is basically the end.
Yeah.
District 9 and Inglourious Basterds. We're going to start with District 9. So, District 9 comes from the two dudes that were going to make us our Halo movie that got canned.
Yes.
Produced by Peter Jackson, directed by Neil Blomkamp, who is a commercial director who did this really awesome short film we've talked about this before, Alive in Joburg, that was the genesis of this movie, District 9. It's a science fiction film. It was made for $30 million, which, to put that in perspective, is half...
The catering budget for Transformers 2. Yeah.
No, yeah, is half the budget... I won't even bring up other science fiction movies that this is similar to. It is half the budget of the summer's big comedy, Funny People. It is $5 million less than the budget of this summer's low-budget comedy, zero special effects, The Hangover. It's what the story. It takes place in this fiction of a spaceship winding up in Johannesburg, South Africa, and a piece of this ship or a
this happened 20 years ago.
Happened 20 years ago, and a piece of the ship lands, and there's these aliens that South Africa has to deal with, and they section them off in District 9.
A slum.
And then the movie explores what happens in dealing with this problem in a very unique way. It's shot like a, as if it's a documentary. It has more in common, I would say, with Bruno this year in that it's sort of storytelling, but also documentary.
It's sort of The Office meets The Fly meets some sort of action movie.
Right.
Pick aliens. Any action movie.
Yeah.
Aliens.
Yes. So in our summer wager, I said this is going to be the biggest thing this summer.
You compared it to Cloverfield.
Yes. True.
Yes.
I don't want those two sentences linked. But
you did it, not me.
No, but I didn't mean it that way. But anyway, so Jeff, was I right?
Yeah, the movie's phenomenal. It's phenomenal. I was absolutely blown away by it. It's a shame, actually, I think, that Neil Blomkamp didn't get a chance to do the Halo movie. It's understandable that now he's saying that even if they offered it to him again, he would say no, because clearly this is what he would have done with Halo. I think this is the kind of movie he wanted to make for Halo, and it's a shame he didn't, because I think what Christopher Nolan did for superhero movies, he has done for the video game movie. And it's a shame that this doesn't have a video game franchise label on it, because it is every bit a video game movie. You have never seen a story like this on the screen at all, ever. But you have seen a story like this in every video game you've played. It is a video game story. The guy who is a normal, he's Gordon Freeman. He's the normal guy who, through a series of events, is the only one who can use the alien weaponry, and so becomes a badass. It's every video game I've ever played, but he manages to infuse that video game storyline with such emotional power and energy and a real theme that's interesting and compelling. And it's we have this argument all the time, you and I, Dan, that can video games make good films? I think this is proof that they can, because it takes all the tropes, just like Christopher Nolan did for superhero movies, it takes all the tropes of the video game genre, the big action set piece, the big firefight, those, you know, how you get your powers, the way they deal with aliens, and it creates a story that is compelling and important and interesting. I could talk for hours and hours about what they're able to do with special effects and all kinds, and the performance of the lead guy.
Yeah. Charlotte,
Yeah.
I know that because yesterday I had to try to pronounce it, and then they just took it out of the prompter for me. They're like, you don't need to pronounce that name. I totally agree with the fact that this is an amazing movie. I mean, this is an amazing movie. It's funny. It's spooky in a weird way. It's thrilling. It's amazing visual effects. I mean, the visual effects alone are worth talking about. And I have to say, I'm not a big fan of the mockumentary. And I was sort of shocked that you compared it to Bruno, because this movie to me sort of starts the first 10 minutes, it feels like a mockumentary, and then you just forget how you're getting the experiencing the story, and you just get fall in love with the story. And for me, the sort of feel of it being shot documentary, and I mean, realistically, the concept of it being shot documentary falls away halfway through the movie, but you never see the transition. It's almost like a seamless move from documentary film to flat out action movie, and it happens so seamlessly. I mean, the guy has able to do that balance of the documentary footage, and you know, it just all works amazingly. And at the end of the day, it's great to see an original sci-fi concept that's not a remake. It's not the remake of a book.
It's not based on a video game.
And I do agree that that's awesome video game storytelling. However, it's just so nice and refreshing to see something that high concept. And it sort of brings my faith back in the fact that we're going to start seeing some really cool high concept sci-fi movies and done really, really well.
Yeah,
I thank you, Peter Jackson, for saying,
helping make it.
This is a big deal because it is.
This is a very hyperbolic statement, but I really do mean it. I think like Star Wars was in the 70s, like The Matrix was in 99, this movie is for now. This really is one of those movies. This is, as you're watching it, it's such a gem of an experience to see something that you have never seen before. And as you're watching it, you're like, I've never seen this before, like this. I'm more with Alex, not that you were arguing, but I disagree. I think that those video games come from movies. And I'm really glad that, and so I didn't really see this as video game storytelling, and I'm glad that he didn't do Halo. I'm glad that he did do this because as you just said, it's like it proves, and this now opens the door for, oh yeah, we should give those guys that script that isn't based on a video game money to make some money, as opposed to let's only make green light the things that are
known just, properties or remakes.
But you didn't see all the Halo-ness in this movie?
A little bit.
Headspace was in Halo.
He made the short film before he did Halo, and this is exactly that short film.
Well, but the first half is. Second half is Halo.
Separate conversation off camera. But I want to say too that movies like Guess Who's Coming to Dinner and Do the Right Thing preach to the choir. They talk about racism.
Yes.
People that are completely open, like that are like, yes, oh, we need to do something about rape. But people that are racist and see those movies don't really see won't watch that movie. They will go and see District 9.
Yeah.
And this does more for that cause. It's medicine in your ice cream.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it's incredible.
Yeah. And it's so great that it was shot with all sort of no-name actors, so you really got that feel of being
not just no-name actors. That lead is the first acting he's ever done.
He's
a producer and director. Yeah,
and he's owned a
absolutely
talent
amazing.
Agency.
He's really great.
And it's funny.
It's so funny.
Okay,
and best integration of effect, character acting with live human acting.
Yeah,
I mean, there's a whole conversation we could have about this in relation to Avatar.
So we haven't seen Avatar yet. Okay.
Right.
So Inglourious Basterds.
Dun, 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 dun.
So the new one from Quentin Tarantino.
Captain Stabs-a-Lot.
So pioneered independent cinema, basically responsible for independent films making money and being mainstream with Pulp Fiction. Hasn't made a shit ton of movies. Didn't want to curse there, but it came out. hasn't made a poop ton of movies, but the movies he's made have made a mark.
Thanks for going with poop ton, though. It's way classier.
Yeah, way classier.
So I remember being excited for Inglourious Basterds in college.
Right.
And then he decided to make Kill Bill, and now we're finally getting his Dirty Dozen for Jews.
That's a great way to put it.
In Nazi.
I think that's
it's basically
in Nazi.
He said the opening. It was the script was once called Once Upon a Time in Nazi Occupied France, which is what ended up being the first title of the chapter or whatever.
Yeah.
It is so. Tarantino has done. He's really done what every movie. He's we know the story of Tarantino as a movie geek. He worked in a video store and he's then made movies. And he's done what every geek would dream. He's tackled every genre he adored growing up.
The gangster movie, the kung fu movie,
and now the
war movie.
The war film. Not only a war film, he killed two birds with one stone, a spaghetti western.
Mm-hmm.
So Alex.
Yes.
What did you think of Inglourious? Oh, so, okay. Okay. What's the story? It's Brad Pitt and a team of
Inglourious
Basterds. Jewish bastards. Jewish soldiers, special forces soldiers in Nazi-occupied France go on this mission to
strike fear in the heart
and
of the
kill
Nazis.
Kill as many. Although I will say that, well, I mean, okay. Okay. So Alex, what did you think?
Because the movie is sort of about that.
Exactly. That's what I was going to say.
But it's also a Tarantino movie, so it's about a lot of things.
So what did you think?
Well, before I get into what I think, I do want to say, did not like Kill Bill very much at all. Really actively disliked Drive Death Man.
Death Proof?
Death Proof.
Which I loved.
So I've been a little wary of the Tarantino. And again, we'll go to my usual cliche at this point, which is, didn't really thrill me based on the trailer. I loved this movie. I had a blast from beginning to end. You could put the opening scene of this movie up against any tension-filled scene in any movie, and I think this will kick the crap out of it. The first scene, and first off, the guy who plays, I think it's Later is his name, Hans
Christoph
Later?
Waltz.
Christoph Waltz.
Lana?
Mind-blowingly good actor. The first scene of this movie is long, is quiet, is thought-provoking, and is heart-wrenching. And to me, that just set the tone. Because you go from these, you oscillate from these crazy, outlandish scenes of, hell yeah, kill those damn Nazis in a very bad way, Tarantino, to this like really artful, tense storytelling. I mean, the scenes that are happening just with little lines and looks, it's heart-stoppingly suspenseful. I had a blast. I mean, it gets a little silly. It gets a little silly at the end. But it was great. I'd tell anybody to go see it. It was great.
You know, growing up as a child, I think the most influential filmmakers undoubtedly were Steven Spielberg and George Lucas. They framed who I was as a young person. But in high school, the film and college, the filmmaker that had the most impact on me is Quentin Tarantino. He's the one that sort of made me feel like I wanted to make movies and be involved in that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm a huge fan of his, and I think this is a masterpiece. I mean, maybe this is an episode for hyperbole, because we have two really amazing films, but yeah. I am not ashamed to say, I think this is a masterpiece. We talked last year when Doubt and Frost Nixon came out, I kind of used this idea of dialogue as action scene almost.
Yeah.
This does that. They're marketing this movie like it's an action movie. It's not. There's very, very, very few moments of action, but the dialogue scenes are as action-packed as any action scene on the screen. It is a master storyteller at work using incredible actors with fantastic writing and a fable and wish fulfillment in a way you've never seen on cinema. Mm. Also, I need to say,
it's all revenge movies are.
Yeah, sure. But I need to say that this is an international movie in a way that no other filmmaker has the guts to do.
Yeah, it's like six different languages throughout the movie. I mean, they only
and
speak English
rarely. And he deftly switches between them, gives audience reasons why people change languages, using actors that are bi and tri and quadlingual.
Man,
you know, you must rush out and see this. If you are over 18, this is a film you have to see. It's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Dan, what'd you think? That's
his
Tarantino review.
If you're watching this episode.
That was his Tarantino review.
Yes. Agreed. Amazing. It's by far his best movie for me since Pulp Fiction.
Mm-hmm. It might be better than Pulp Fiction.
Yeah, I don't know if I can say that for me. Christoph Waltz, the villain. We get a on-screen villain of the likes of, who's the guy who played Is It Safe? Marathon Man?
Yeah, give me two seconds. Keep going.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, Jew hating.
Laurence
Olivier. And the Joker and Anton Chigurh. Yeah. We have this dude. Don't remember the character's name. So not as memorable as those guys.
I think it's Hans Linder.
But Yeah, and what?
The Jew Hunter.
Well, Quentin. Okay, the other genre I didn't mention is it's this Hitchcockian suspense movie. Ugh. That Quentin Tarantino now gets to tackle. And all of his movies, what is his style, is that they are all really short films that are longer because of these very spaghetti western, long take dialogue sequences.
And the suspense, every time we talk about
suspense movie, I talk about the hierarchy of knowledge. But it isn't what, sometimes for him, it's we know the bomb is under the table and no one else does. Sometimes they know the bomb is under the table and we don't know. But it's never because we see the bomb, or sometimes it is that clear as we see the bomb and blah, blah, blah. But sometimes it's that suspense logic but through dialogue sequences. Mm-hmm. And that, I mean, really that is, it's even his short film that he did for Four Rooms, that is every Quentin Tarantino movie is suspense through dialogue, but close to what Jeff said, I mean, it's kind of perfected here.
Yeah, opening scene.
And not only that, the music, he did the most incredible thing with music. So basically he used the scores to all of his favorite movies. He used the scores to spaghetti westerns, to blaxploitation films, to war films from the 70s, and used their scores as the score for this movie. Mm. Awesome. It really is a movie geek's feast.
I can't wait for him to work again. He is such an exciting filmmaker.
I just want to see Inglourious Basterds again.
Yeah, me too, man.
So, as you may be aware by following Jeff and I's tweets, I have recently gotten very, very into Magic the Gathering, as has Jeff.
Somehow we both missed this boat back when it was hugely popular.
I tried it back then and it just kind of, you know what I mean? But now that we're kind of into tabletop D&D and all these games and stuff, and Munchkin especially, it was like a logical next step.
Right.
Let's play the one that everybody plays. So
finally play it.
Now we are getting in connected to our 12-year-old selves and playing Magic the Gathering. Dan, on the other hand, was the Magic the Gathering championship of 1987.
But I was exactly 12 years old when I played it.
So what we decided was to have Jeff challenge Dan, and I got my white glove,
I smacked him in
the face.
It's
been a long time
I will be the arbiter.
So
what we're gonna do is we have two pre-made decks. We have a green deck, which is the custom creatures deck, and a white deck, which is the Army of Justice.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's what I say. So I'm gonna go ahead and randomly randomize these with my randomizing
the Army
hands.
For Justice. Rubbing them on his crotch.
Random.
Which one do you want?
Pick a hand. Left or right?
This hand.
Custom creatures, Army
Justice.
Of Justice.
We know who's fighting for good.
And I shall be the life giver and taker.
This is advanced level.
Don't read the cards.
All right, how many we got?
Seven.
Oh, shadazes.
Yep. How do we decide who goes first?
I will make that decision arbitrarily as the arbiter.
So
Dan, you can go first. What?
Let me just refresh my memories.
You can ask the arbiter any questions.
So, the upper right corner is how many resources
it requires.
And then the bottom right corner is your hit points, or?
Oh shit, this is gonna be hard. The amount of damage you deal is on the left,
left
and the amount of damage you can absorb is on the
right.
That's basically hit points.
Get prepared for the Norwood Ranger.
What? How many damage does it do? One? How many hit points does it have? Two? Oh my god. All right, so I draw though, right?
You draw. Yeah.
Sweet. Sundale Hawk! Up in that bitch.
We're into attack phase. Would you like to attack?
Yeah, I mean, it'd be silly not to.
Okay.
This is true, it would be silly not to.
Yeah.
Okay, so you don't have to tap to attack.
Oh, you don't?
No.
Oh,
you just push it forward.
And you have to tap him.
Tap him. Besides these. There you go. I'm gonna let that go through.
No!
One damage to me!
First strike.
I'm gonna attack with that hawk, which you cannot defend.
The hawk deals one damage. The game is now even.
The foot.
Draw a card.
Mm-hmm. Actually, he's
funny. Yeah. Man. Love that picture.
Honestly. All right, I am going to attack with both. Plunk. Actually, attacking doesn't cause future attack.
So you're doing three damage?
You can't block that guy, so.
I think I'll just take it.
So that'll take.
Yeah, he'll take it.
If you can block her with either of these two people.
Yeah.
So
and
if
this
you.
This will kill this person.
And not kill her with that one. But
right,
if you, do
but if you
this
use
one,
this one.
Mutually assured
yeah,
destruction.
He gets thrown
this
away.
This killed and that person
and that
gets
person
killed?
Gets yeah. killed. So you don't have to take the three.
No, I'm going to take the damage.
Okay. 16 to 19. Good job, sir. Good All job right. yourself, sir.
These hey. Golden wings and learn to fly again. Learn to live so free.
Kick this guy, because this is the Can't only one that you're person? Worried about. He could, but you want to keep this guy around for this chick.
Right.
And that guy can kill this guy.
I see how it is. See how it is? See,
I'm doing the same thing. If you needed help, I'd tell
you
the same
I have not heard
thing.
You help me once, sir.
You have not needed help, sir. You've played this recently. But it is up to you.
Wait, let me just think this. Why? All right, I think I'm going to attack with both then. Boom.
My phone agrees.
Boom.
I'll
take it all?
Yeah, take it all.
This game is afoot, gentlemen. 15 to 17.
Obviously attack with both of these guys.
Cool. 3 points of damage goes through because of something you did. You got a game here, 15-14.
Play this guy?
So that's a buff.
Yeah,
who do you want to put it on?
You play that on something.
Ew, you're right. Because it looked like a guy.
Yeah. Actually, it becomes a 6-6.
Yeah, because of
because
the already.
Because he also, well, now you've just put another enchantment
on the floor,
in the team.
On the team.
So he goes up to a 4-4.
And I played,
and you have
did
four,
I not
four.
Just play a green spell?
I just point you up one.
All right.
That's ridiculous. I think I just lost the game.
No,
that's
not
true. No.
Because I can't, I don't, like right now, I don't know if I'm going to attack
Well, because here's the thing.
Because I don't want to spend her.
Well, so you could choose to use her as a defensive person, which right. means you can just go through and go, well, I'll kill this person and that person.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Or you can choose her to be aggressive, and you'll put her in, and then he has to choose, do I sacrifice one of my people to stop 8 points? So you have at least 3 rounds where you can suck up the damage, and it doesn't go to you. Do you see what I'm saying?
Let's keep moving. 8-8 is coming at me.
Yep. Yeah.
Well, I guess I sacrificed the veteran to stop that. But then the next round, it's going to happen all over again. All right. Dead.
So that guy's tapped.
I just killed.
And bring my Angel of Mercy into this B.
Oh.
When the Angel of Mercy comes in, you gain 3 life.
Oh, boy. Yep. See, this game, up and down.
Throw down Master Decoy.
Master Decoy.
Our skilled decoy can throw your enemies off your trail. A master Epic. Decoy can survive to do it again.
Epic.
So
he can tap that guy and then choose any of your creatures to tap if he has a resource.
Wow.
He needs one
well, there
resource.
You go. That's
there
it.
Go.
That's it.
What?
I'm going to attack with both.
Okay.
Because he can't kill either of them.
You're beating him handily.
I know. This thing is just going to keep being more powerful until he can one-shot me.
Yeah. Well, but you'll always have creatures in front.
I guess.
For a time.
All right, so what are you doing? All right, are you bringing the pain, obviously?
Yeah, I guess I'll do that.
Yeah. So you're, I mean, you can sacrifice either of these two guys.
It's redonkulous, dude. I mean, just you're just destroying me.
But you're still at 20. I mean, that's the thing. It's all so far by the numbers.
You don't know what you're gonna draw.
This is a good game. This is a very good game. I feel like you guys are evenly balanced.
Because if he onslaughts me right now,
you'll be
they're all spent,
him.
And then I. If, you said, if I didn't draw this card, it would be like this game would be totally different. Like I'd be getting whooped.
Uh oh.
I can go above 20, right?
You can go above 20, yeah.
Going above 20.
Wow. See, that's not the balancing,
this is the
Jeff.
Thing. This is the balance. You've got the big whoomp up
and
creatures,
he's got the big
and
health.
He's got lots of heals and things flying in over top and.
What am I not gonna do?
I need a 6.
Oh my god.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
What is that?
Oh,
a craw worm?
The craw worm.
It's 6-4.
Alright, what else are you doing? Are you attacking me?
Hold on.
I got no offense, man. He's got like all offense. Look at him, like a 6 and an 11? That's insane.
Well,
you can beat me in one attack.
I would suggest spreading these out.
Right, so I think maybe.
Maybe the new
craw.
Guy.
Yeah. So now he's got regeneration, which by the way makes that a 12-12.
It does make that 12-12.
It's a new enchantment.
And
it's also a green spell?
It is a green spell. So you get 14
I have 0 cards in my hand right now.
come.
Well, clearly I'm attacking with my 12-12.
Right, so I'm gonna kill Master Decoy. To stave off that Armageddon.
But now if you get a card in there that, and there is a card in there that gives you trample.
Then I'm dead. Then I'm dead.
Yeah. Well, you're just not.
No, I'm dead.
Pretty close.
In that situation.
Pretty close to dead. So you're going to take one away and then 3 points of damage come in.
Jeez, Jeff, you might.
He's whittling you.
I'm in bad, I'm in a bad way.
Okay.
He's just too powerful.
Because you have 23 health and he has 12.
That's how it's balanced.
You are whittling him down by negating
But he's just
going to
kill
them.
Me.
Well, we'll see if you can whittle fast enough.
Don't get angry.
You have enough.
Don't drive angry.
You have enough. You got three. This is three. You have 5 rounds.
Yeah, but okay.
I'm just saying.
So this is a 6-4.
Really smart. That's a 6-4.
So these two dudes are going to die to stave off elimination.
So you're just doing 1-1. No, that's all right, valid.
I'm going to die.
Well,
it's inevitable. Because I don't have enough. I'm not drawing enough cards per round to save off two deaths. It's inevitable.
Maybe. I mean, you still have 3 full rounds.
So he does 3 damage plus an extra 1 from the ballista squad.
So that is 18 points of damage.
All right. So I'm going to spend 1. And reduce the by 4. That's all I can do.
So
it's 14 points of damage. That's all I can do. I have to pray that the next card I pick up is something really good.
Yeah.
That's what I have to pray for, because I have 1 round right now.
Yeah.
Your turn.
Fuck. Not what I was hoping for. All right.
No, but, I mean, do your 6 points.
Yeah, I can't block it with this guy.
No, you can't block it with that guy. So
I can't block. I don't have no flying creatures.
This is happening. This is happening.
So I have now 4
But it doesn't matter
damage.
Because.
No, but still, if you can weather this storm and do another round, you've got him. But this is a close game. I mean, this is not
this
a block.
Is a nail biter.
Yeah, 4.
Nail biter.
Yeah. Right. So I do
everything. You gotta do everything. This is your Alamo.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have a 13.
Which will kill me.
A 6.
Which won't kill me.
And a 2.
So I'll get down to 1 hit point. I don't have any choice. I have to block him.
Right.
I don't have any choice. So I'm down to 1 hit point.
Oh, shit.
You win.
Not necessarily.
Because now all my guys are spent.
Yeah, and you got 2 flying guys.
All right, so I did that. So
let's just play it out. Holy shit.
So I block him, but he's dead. Those guys are spent.
So this is spent. So then.
Wow.
8 points of damage. You're down to 1 point, sir.
Unbelievable.
So
all the complaints, all the time. Same munchkin tactics.
Well, did you see what happened? I went from 23 to 9, dude.
Yeah, dude. If you'd done that, that was.
Yeah, but your whittles along the way. It was
all right,
balanced.
I'm drawing.
It's a planes card.
He's spending these 2 to bring that dude in, and then these guys are attacking for 6 points of damage, which I win.
Yep. -2.
Holy mother of pearl!
I had no way of blocking anything.
I held on by
gentlemen,
the chinny
that
chin
was
chin.
A very close game. Because magic can sometimes be, and you're welcome for arbitrating.
Good arbitrating. Good arbitrating.
Appreciate it. So now you can see the fun in a fast-paced game of.
It was not fast-paced.
Well, fast-paced to them. Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, dude, good game, and
now you can see why we're.
You really could have gone either way. I mean, he was charging, and he unleashed the fury.
So
I'm sure there's going to be people writing in and telling us all the
things that we were doing wrong, or things we were doing wrong. Great job, Magic the Gathering FT.
Video games! So you just saw us playing a little tabletop Magic the Gathering. So I thought it might be cool to spend the first little bit of the video game segment talking about the Magic the Gathering Xbox Live Arcade game, because we're noticing a few of these cool tabletop card games and board games are making the transition to downloadable titles.
Settlers of Catan.
Settlers of Catan, which I would love to cover as a tabletop on our show.
Sure.
Uno, of course, is huge on Xbox Live Arcade.
That was like the first thing I played on Xbox Live Arcade. I loved it.
It's one of the most successful games that they have. So we just played Magic the Gathering. What did you think of the Xbox Live conversion?
I thought it was great. I thought, first off, because we'd just gotten into Magic.
Yeah, we're a little bit behind the curve.
I know Dan played it when he was 4. But
1996 called in once
exactly.
Activity back.
So, but I will say, I actually played it a little bit back in the day, and it's a little complicated to grasp all of the nuances. It's pretty straightforward to be like, this is how you play. All right, but then there's all these nuances. And the best way that I found to learn was playing the Xbox Live Arcade game.
The tutorial specifically, or just the game itself?
The tutorial catches you up to speed, but then playing round after round, our buddy Zand has become a ninja on the Xbox Live Arcade game. I mean, he has like all the decks unlocked, all the secret cards, like it's crazy town. So I really, really, really enjoyed the Xbox Live game. From what I have been told from friends who are big fans of Magic, have been playing for a long time, it could use an update to the deck creation. That you can't really spread all your cards out and go, okay, this one, that one, this one, that one, this one, that's my 60.
So it feels like a little bit more for beginners than for the seasons.
Maybe, than for the seasonal stuff.
What do you think about the experience of playing on a computer rather than sitting in front of a table with physical cards?
Well, one of the problems that I've always had with tabletop games and card games is, I mean, we have this with D&D. When was the last time we played D&D? It's kind of hard to get together to do that, you know what I mean?
So convenience trumps.
Convenience experience. Definitely trumps. And also, there is something to be said about the fact that you get a little bit of animation. And also, as I said, it was fun because a lot of times with card games, especially when you're learning them, it's always like, I do this. Wait, can I do that?
Yeah.
And I was like, I think you
can. So the game
can tell
you.
So it's really easy to go, I can't do that, so I won't even hit my button. But I'm going to do this. So there's a little bit of that, like, speed up and less learning curve.
I agree. I definitely think it's a great way to learn how to play the game. It's probably a great way to learn any game. I find playing those card games like Uno, I find to be the most relaxing, pleasant experience. And there's something in playing this kind of game. It's a different way to interact with your Xbox, but a lot of fun. And I think that it's... You know, one of the deterrents in playing Magic or any tabletop game in real life, IRL, is, there's cards and you're eating chips and it's greasy and you got your chits
this is
out.
The slovenly
and,
problem.
No, and it's just like, it's hard to sort of manage. You need space on the table. And
whereas you can get all that stuff on your controller and it's no big deal.
Yeah, exactly.
I agree with you guys. I have a hard time playing Settlers of Catan on the Xbox Live because there's something about that physical experience of having that stuff in front of you that's just more satisfying for me. Mm. But I didn't really experience that with Magic. I wonder, do you guys think that the game would have been, would you have liked them to put a little more effort and make it more like battle chess?
No, and I'm kind of glad they didn't.
Okay.
Because I think that steals from the cathartic joy of the card game itself.
What do you mean by that?
Meaning that there'd be animations of them
the
fighting,
battle,
like the actual
it's
battle.
Some sort of more video gaminess rather than just a visual representation of the card game. Hmm. You know? No? Not so much?
No, I might enjoy. I mean, there's a little bit of that, but you mean
like
a cut to a...
No, it just shows the... Instead of showing the cards, that more like when we played... PlayStation Eye game. What was
I have Judgment.
I have Judgment.
Yeah.
Yeah, which was exactly this, actually, taking a card game and bringing it to life and fighting, which was
But you
cool.
still had to actually have it out and move the card.
There's some imagination involved in the tabletop form, and there's still a little bit of imagination involved in the Xbox Live version in imagining this. I've got a worm, and I do this crazy thing, and... I think more flourishes would have been cool. You don't need to cut to a CG scene where that happens. You can just have flourishes, and that might have been nice, but...
Yeah. Overall, I have to say, the entire experience I've had learning Magic at this late date...
Yeah!
It has been so fun, and it's really the sort of reputation of Magic, I think, got in the way a little bit for me of enjoying a really well-made game.
Yeah, me too. There's a reason why it's king, and has been for, like, 15 years.
Yeah. Speaking of well-made games, there's a company called Vanillaware that makes really well-made 2D hand-drawn games. You may remember us in our first year reviewing Odin Sphere, which is really one of my favorite PS2 games of all. They did another one called Grim Grimoire. I think that's how you pronounce it. Anyway, so their newest game is called Muramasa, the Demon Blade. And we got an early look at it. We went over to the studio and took a look at... it's being published by Ignition this time. And it is very similar art style to those games I mentioned in that it's all hand-drawn again. It's all 2D sort of parallax scrolling. But I think there's much more of an emphasis this time on action. It is very much in that Castlevania style, Metroid style of the action heavy, explore the world, find the way to get to the next screen.
You can buy maps so that you can see where you're going.
Yeah, there is some RPG stuff. There's like a cooking thing where you can cook stuff, but not nearly to the extent that Odin Sphere had, which had full-on growing your own plants and stuff, which I loved. Dan,
on the Wii, no Waggle.
Right.
It's not like Waggle, and cooking isn't Cooking Mama.
Which a really interesting choice is that it is a Wii-exclusive game, but there is absolutely no motion control to it.
Right.
It is it requires the nunchuck, and you move with the nunchuck, and you attack with by pushing buttons. That's it.
Yeah.
It also supports the Wave Bird, which I was very excited to hear.
Yeah.
You look like you were having a great time playing it.
Well, he was the winner chicken dinner. This guy was like Liquid Ninja.
Skills McGee, yeah.
In an episode given to Hyperbole, I will carry the torch in saying, not only is this the best looking Wii game, this
ever?
May be one of the best looking games. This is in the pantheon of best looking games of all time.
Well, that helps that it's, you know, hand-drawn, hand-animated.
It's
clearly a labor of love.
Gorgeous. And along the best looking, how do we see those things? We see them moving. The animation is also spectacular. I mean, I don't even know about the gameplay. It's so good looking, it almost doesn't matter. I was actually really happy watching other people play, because when you play, you're so engaged in what you're doing, you can't appreciate all that stuff. But it's frickin'
Well, did you have fun playing?
Gorgeous. I did have fun. I think I found it to be very easy, and I think...
Oh, well.
I think...
For the master name.
No, but I think I just was sort of an autopilot doing what I know I should be doing, and I look forward to... I feel like I can't even comment on that yet, because I think when it gets more challenging, I will then have to use more of the depth of the controls, because I wasn't really, I was just...
But it gave you a very good first impression.
But it gave me a good first impression. One thing I don't like in games, and this is just in that genre of games, is when you're going from screen to screen, and I always sort of lose track of where I am and what I have to do.
The map didn't help you?
Even that map.
Overlay.
I'm like, oh wait, because Shane, who was showing us the game, used a great phrase, and I don't... Something, traversal recall or retro traversion. Something where you traverse the floor and then you have to go back. Once you get something, so then you have to go back a few screens to use what
it's
you got.
It's very Castlevania, Metro.
Yeah, I don't like that kind of game. What I would compare this also to, by the way, I was just thinking the whole time, one of my favorite games for the NES, Legend of Cage.
Okay.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yes, I know what you're talking about, but it wasn't one of my favorite games.
it was very difficult.
Yeah.
Where it's that same, Japanese forest, and you're jumping up and down and up and down and moving left and right in one solid lock screen.
Well, they also, I mean, you know, they also compared it to Devil May Cry, which I think is valid because it's a very high, intense combo chaining experience.
Right.
I love that this is a Wii exclusive. And I'm saying that because this, to me, just proves that, one, no Wii game should look bad.
Well...
No Wii game should look bad.
It's two apples and oranges to something like Conduit.
Maybe, but you know
apples
what?
Apples and oranges.
I would have loved to have seen Conduit the side-scroller hand-painted. So I feel like, no excuse. Well, it's on the Wii, so it's going to look like crap. That shouldn't be true. Two... I really don't think that people should force... I feel like all the games that we've reviewed, most of the games, not all the games, because a lot of them, you know, the golf stuff, it makes perfect sense to use the motion plus or the motion way that you do it. And the sports games, I love those games. I feel like the games that we play on the Wii, it's always like, here's a really cool game. Oh, crap, it's on the Wii. How can we get them to move their hand in a weird way that makes sense in the game? And so I'm constantly playing these games going... This would be a good game if I didn't have to do this all the time.
A lot of people like that.
I'm not reviewing this for other people. I'm reviewing it for me. And so this is how I feel about the Wii. Sitting down and playing this game, the moment he said, well, there's no motion stuff because it just didn't make sense for this game, I was like, developers actually asked themselves that question? Like, that's amazing.
Right.
Because I sat down and played this game and I was like, I don't care this is on the Wii. I don't need to even play it with the WaveBird. I loved playing it with the nunchuck, and it definitely felt like a different experience, an experience I would only have on the Wii. And I loved it. I had a blast. I'm excited to get this game. I'm excited that it'll actually give me a reason to turn my Wii on again, except when people come over and drink and want to play tennis.
If it was,
so
if,
that's for me how I feel.
If it was in HD on the PS3 or 360, I would even be a little more happy, I think.
Maybe, but I feel like...
Then I wouldn't have to turn my... It's very easy. My Xbox is always on.
Right. Well, I agree with that.
I'd love to see those things in HD. Yeah.
Right, but I feel like as far as a Wii exclusive goes, this gets me excited to play it on the Wii.
I agree. I feel like,
oh no, it's on the Wii, so I'm not gonna like
it. You know, a lot of people made a big hay about hardcore games on the Wii, like Mad World and what was the other one that was right around the same time? Oh, probably Conduit. Yeah. But being these sort of litmus tests for whether the hardcore games can live on the Wii. And I think this game is even more, if you're a hardcore gamer and you want something great, this is a game that looks really fantastic. Now, obviously, we only played an hour of it, so this isn't like a full review, but it really gave a fantastic first impression. And, you know, I think there have been great looking games. I mean, Mario Galaxy is a great looking game on the Wii.
I agree with that. Yeah. I definitely agree with that.
This looks fantastic. I loved Odin Sphere so much. If you haven't played that and you have a PS2 or a backwards compatible PS3, I highly recommend
Gamefly.
It. And you have Gamefly, which may or may not be a sponsor this week.
Oh, whatever. It's in. Yeah. Yeah, freebie.
Anyway, yeah, Muramasa looks really, really good. And it's coming out very soon. I think it's September something. So
cool.
Yeah,
Can't wait for more. All right, people. Well, before we get to our email, we do want to thank our sponsors. We have some amazing sponsors like Squarespace.com. If you have not checked out Squarespace.com, I pity the fool, actually.
Whoa.
That's that much. I did. All of our sites are hosted on Squarespace. It's the best WYSIWYG editor you will ever use, and that is just going along with the hyperbole of this show.
I don't think
it may actually not be hyperbole. So head over to squarespace.com. They'll handle all your hosting and manage all of your software integrations. I made that up, so hopefully they do that. Also, if you use the coupon code TRS when you check out, you will save an additional 10% off the lifetime of your site. Just go do it.
Yeah, and somebody on Facebook just told me that my site, jeffcanada.com, which was made using Squarespace, was just named in the New England Journal of Medicine as the best, third best treatment for gastrointestinal disease. So there's that.
I could really use that.
You should go to his site.
Running game!
On a much more serious note, the National Fight Against Drunk Driving, Over the Limit, Under Arrest, is sponsoring our show, what you need to understand is that from August 21st through Labor Day, police are going to be out in much fuller force enforcing anyone who is over the limit.
They do this periodically, and they catch a lot of people.
And what that means, if you get caught, legal fees, attorneys,
fines, losses,
no driver's license, have fun with that, horrible.
Public shunning.
By the way, you could kill somebody. Not cool. Good. So don't drink and drive. I don't drink, and I was often the designated driver, and there are so many easy ways to, have fun without drinking.
I have
lots of fun in my life. B, go out and not drink. C, go out, drink, and then get home safely. So.
Yeah,
taxis, limos.
A lot of taxis, especially
friends
around
that can
holidays,
drive you,
they
subways.
Have taxi, like free taxi services. Yeah. There's a lot of really
also, if you're the designated driver, you're often the most popular guy.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, we love going out with Dan.
Yeah, it's
hot
amazing.
Girls get drunk. You are the guy who takes them home.
That
and
is a
different
creepy.
PSA. Got
a little,
into
bad got a little, got a little
That's
creepy.
A different PSA.
All right, good times. Don't drink and drive.
Yeah.
Also, GoDaddy.com is your place to get the your piece
of
the internet.
Long, but it's probably gonna be really quick. We'll watch that.
They're the place to go. That's where we all got our domain names. You can buy domain names there for very inexpensive. You can get hosting options. You can get all kinds of stuff for managing your site and squeezing the most out of it. It's fantastic. They are amazing there with the customer service. I always talk about that when I talk about them because it blew me away when I the customer service that I got from getting my own domain name there. Also, because they're such great supporters of Revision 3, there are tons of promo codes. If you go to revision3.com/GoDaddy, there are a bunch of promo codes. So pretty much anything you're looking to get, you can find a discount. So check that out.
Epic. Also, you know what? Check out all the shows at Revision 3. No specific one in particular, but just see them
us.
All. Oh, is it?
I think it's us.
Oh, well, then there you go.
Out.
See all of us. all right, let's get to our email. This is from Joe Steiner. age 11.
Hey!
Awesome.
Thanks for watching, Joe.
Hey, Red guys, happy birthday, Jeff and Alex.
Thanks, Joe.
I've been watching the show since October, and I think it's the best show I've ever seen. Love it. You can get in on that.
Hyperbole.
That's a hyperbole five. You guys have gotten me into geocaching. I found a couple in my area, Windsor, Ontario, Canada.
Cool.
Now, here's my question. Since it's Alex's birthday and was recently Jeff's birthday, I was wondering, what is your favorite birthday?
And Jeff was at some point this year.
What was your favorite birthday gift and why? Always on the show, Joe Steiner. Squiggy Co.
I think he wanted us to say Squiggy Co. for some reason.
Squiggy Co.
But I don't know.
We just like shouted out to like all his bros.
Squiggy Co.
So Jeffrey Cannata, you had a recent birthday.
I did, and you guys got me a Kindle, which I'm really, really digging.
But what was your favorite of all time?
You know, it's hard to remember specific gifts, but I can tell you my favorite birthday of all time was my 18th, and that was because my mom threw me a surprise party. Mm-hmm. My mom and my dad's birthday is 2 days after mine.
Okay.
So and it happened to be the year that I turned 18 and my dad turned 50.
Wow.
So it was kind of a big deal for both of us. And so she threw sort of a co-surprise party, but she really pulled it off really well and got all of my friends involved, and I had to work that day, and they all like conspired to keep me around longer so they could set up, It was really, really cool, and it was the first time I'd ever had a surprise party or been legitimately surprised. I was really legitimately didn't think that anything was happening, and
interesting.
And it was a blast, man.
Interesting.
Have you guys ever had a surprise party for you?
No,
I don't think so.
I always wanted one.
Well, surprise!
We're doing that
right now.
Doesn't work that way. It's good though.
We can bring out 40 of your friends that are hanging out in the.
No. In the wings.
It'd be really awkward if we had a surprise party planned for Alex tonight.
I know, and I was like, I just totally. But yeah. What better way to throw him off the scent?
That's a good point.
It's true.
I too just racked my brain for a gift, but I distinctly remember my 21st birthday. Did not go out drinking. I grew up in the outside Philadelphia area, where the Jersey Shore is just a mere hour away. So it was always the impulse. Like you guys think Vegas is this? Like, oh my gosh, yeah. We can just go to Vegas tonight. The shore was like AC, Atlantic City, was just an hour away. So my 21st birthday, now I can legally go gamble. They enforce that in the casinos there, so I really couldn't,
they do.
I never
they
did
do,
gamble
they do
before.
In Vegas too, yeah.
So it was like I can actually go and gamble for the first time. Went to play blackjack.
Nice.
My first hand, I was dealt blackjack, which is
story tells itself.
21, by the way.
Because that's your age.
I proceeded to win eight blackjacks that night, winning a total of 210, 21 with the $0 on my 21st birthday.
So I guess that deal you made with the devil really worked out.
Yeah.
So it was a really great birthday, my friend Adam.
I will say your soul probably worth more than $210.
Yes.
But
hopefully.
He's used it.
I'm going to say a recent... I'm gonna say last year's birthday and this year's birthday sort of combined. Last year, I've always wanted to fly planes, fly helicopter. Like I've just been always enamored by flight, as it were. And last year, my little sister got me a flight lesson, like two hours flying in a helicopter, which was an amazing experience because I actually got to fly the helicopter and it was really fun. And also subsequently made me realize I don't want to fly helicopters. So, great experience, and I was like, I really want to get my fixed wing pilot's license. Well, flash two, just today, my fiance Heather got me my first lesson in flying a fixed wing airplane. Sweet. So I'm gonna start taking, finally, I've been talking about it years and years and years, I'm gonna finally start taking lessons to get my pilot's license.
That's awesome.
Which I'm very excited about. So that was, so far, best two gifts.
I'll ride your tail any day.
Yeah.
It got weird.
It did get weird. All right, well, thank you, Joe, so much.
Not a
weird reference. No, not a friend thing.
Actually,
why is that not a friend thing?
Because I just, like,
bit the air.
Yeah.
You know what? Val Kilmer can pull it up.
Yeah.
Anyway, thank you, Joe, so much for the email. If you would like to have your email read on the show, please feel free to send it to fans@totallyradshow.com.
That's also the email address you'd use to send us a background.
Yes, if like
you,
Sam.
If you have a redesign of our death machine,
or some other, maybe a love machine. It's like a love shotgun.
God, don't ask for love machines.
What's wrong with a love shotgun?
I'm frightened.
Hi, I am too.
Love shotgun. You can send it to fans of Totally Rad Show. We love them. We love the ones that have to do with things we're talking about that week, so don't feel restricted to anything we just jokingly referenced.
Yes.
Also, check out our forums. It's a really great community of people who are talking about the episode you've just seen. Meet fans, meet people with like-minded interests there. It's really, really cool.
Build relationships.
Yeah.
And follow us on Twitter.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm at DannyTRS.
I'm at Alex Albrecht.
I'm at Jeff Cannata.
And that's at Snoop Mikey. Also, go to totallyretro.com to download all the backgrounds that we've done.
Or this background.
Ooh,
this
you know background? What else we should mention? We should mention much more often. So often, people are like, hey, dude, you guys should talk about Nick and Nora's Infinite Playlist, you know? Or, hey, you should talk about this video game. Or, hey, what was the episode where you talked about this thing or that thing, whatever?
Wikifrickipedia.
If you go to our Wikipedia page, some amazing person who should let us know who he is so we can thank him.
Or people, maybe.
Or people. I don't know who's done it. There's a database of every episode we've ever done with every... All the old intros are described there. Even our new ones are described. What the email was.
Maybe somebody recently just went back and added the air date.
Start putting the embed
date.
Codes.
The air date.
The air date they just added. Yeah.
So...
Yeah, very, very helpful. Yeah. Also, you know, if you loved our intros from the first 2 years, the DVD is on sale at the Revision 3 store.
Yes.
And... we've heard some complaints from people saying that I live in a certain country and they don't send to me. Mm. Just found out, we put some pressure on the company that's doing that, and they're adding a bunch of new countries. And I don't know, it's a long list, so I can't specifically say, but maybe check back if you tried, and they may be able to send to your country now because it's all changing.
And also, we have to say, huge success with the limited edition t-shirt, sold out in less than 24 hours, medium
still,
size.
I think a few left available.
There are a few left, but they are going fast, and we are not going to replenish them, hence why they're called limited edition. But we are going to be trying to do that periodically, putting out a nice, fun little, you know,
so
limited edition thing.
So that's www.jinx.com/TRS.
Correct.
We can get all the shirts.
All the shirts, and now a sticker.
So see you at PAX.
Yep.
Yeah.
See you at PAX, people. Well, that is it for this week's edition of the Totally Rad Show. I'm Alex Albrecht.
I'm Jeff Cannata.
I'm Dan Trachtenberg.
Until next time, be well.
Happy birthday, Alex!
What? Did that work?
Why don't you fold the bottom or cut
the
bottom?
Cut
okay. Yeah. Was I in a pugilistic movie? Have I wrestled in movies? Have I had an exorbitant amount of plastic surgery? Am I Harry Belafonte?